The elements of group 14 are almost the most important of all elements of the periodic table. Within this group, the non-metal carbon with this not treating discourse constitutes the basis of life on Earth, whilst the metalloid silicon is vital for the physical structure of the natural environment in the four or crustal rocks. This last element, in conjunction with the metalloid germanium, is also critical for the development of modern high tech, such as semiconductor of optical fibers. The heaviest element of the group, the metallic elements, tin and lead, show also multiple applications in industry and manufacturing, as we will describe in the last section of this week. Once reached this position of the periodic table, this means the middle of the main groups, the most important trend is the increase in the metallic properties understanding within the group. A common feature in the P block, considering the increase in the atomic radius and the associated decrease in ionization energy when we go down the group. This difference in the metallic behavior of the elements also have important consequences in their chemical and physical properties. Related with the physical properties, whereas the three lighter elements, the non-metal carbon and the two semi-metal silicon and germanium, present high melting and boiling points, showing the network covalent bonding, the two metals in the group, tin and lead, are soft low-melting metals, showing both long liquid ranges. In addition, the elements of this group possess the property of catenation, that is, the tendency of an element to form a bond with itself. However, the tendency to catenate decreases down the group as the atomic and ionic radius increase. Other important difference when we go down the group is that, in contrast with the high tendency of carbon to form stable double bonds with itself and other elements, for the rest of the elements of the group this behavior is quite rare. On the other hand, the electron configuration of the other valence shells of group 14 and S2NP2 suggests that oxidation number plus 4 is dominant in the main combination. However, even though this oxidation state is common for all members in covalent bonding, the first three elements of the group, the non-metal carbon and the two semi-metal silicon and germanium, show an oxidation state of minus 4. When they are bonded to more electropositive elements. When we descend in the group, we find that the oxidation state plus 2 is the most stable for tin and lead in ionic compounds, as a result of the inner pair effect in both elements, which for silicon is not really frequent. Therefore, combination of lead in oxidation state 4 are typically strong oxidants and are easily reduced to lead 2. As expected, the first ionization energy and electron affinity values decrease down the group as the atomic radius increase and therefore the reactivity also increase. In addition, the lighter elements of the group, carbon and silicon, are strong oxophiles and fluorophiles. That means that both elements have high affinities for the hard anions oxide and fluoride, as evidenced by the existence of an extensive series of oxo anions, the carbonates and the silicates, for example. However, silicon is more reactive than carbon and forms different binary compounds by combination with models of the non-metal at high temperature. The increase in reactivity is again evidenced when descending from silicon to germanium. While silicon reacts with aqueous alkali, liberating hydrogen, it is insoluble in nitric acid and hydrofluoric acid. Contrarily, germanium forms the dioxide when it reacts with nitric acid, and although it doesn't react with dilute acid and water, it can form germanium tetrachloride and germanium disulfide by reaction with hydrochloric acid and hydrosulfuric acid, respectively. As we continue descending the group, we observe again the increase in reactivity and we start detecting a markedly amphoteric behavior. Tin, for example, reacts with dilute nitric acid to form tin 2 nitrate, although it is little affected by dilute hydrochloric or sulfuric acid. However, when both acids are concentrated Tin is dissolved to form the corresponding sal of tin in oxidation state plus 2, that is, tin 2 chloride and tin 2 sulfate. The amphoteric behavior of tin is exhibited when it is oxidized by hot aqueous alkali, as it is shown in the following equation. In the case of lead, we observe that it is pyrophoric when it's finally divided. However, lead is not considered a reacting metal. In fact, it is well known the inertness of the element, which shows a high resistance to different atmospheres and corrosive chemicals, an aspect that has been crucial for the exploitation of the metals in the ancient times. This seeming contradiction is explained because the reactivity of the metal is usually diminishes that is generally protected by a thin coating of some insoluble product such as oxide, carbonate, sulfate or chloride. So while lead reacts quickly with nitric acid to form the corresponding salt, lead 2 nitrate, liberating oxide of nitrogen, or with organic acid such as acetic acid in the presence of air, it only does slowly with hydrochloric acid or sulfuric acid by forming insoluble lead chloride or lead sulfate on the surface of the metal. Another remarkable aspect about the reactivity of the elements of group 14 is that, with the exception of carbon, they can exhibit hypervalence, and therefore they can act as Lewis acids by forming a stable structure where the element is 5 or 6 coordinated. A typical example is the reaction of tin 4 tetrahalides with allied ions to form octahedral complexes. Interestingly, if we compare the different Lewis acidity of these tin 4 tetrahalides with a complete series of halogens, we observe that it increases as the electron withdrawing power of the halogen increase, that is, from iodine to fluorine, same as silicon tetrahalides, but in the reverse way of what was observed in the case of boron halides. More surprising is the ability of tin 2 dihalides to increase its coordination number, whatever is possible, and behaving more as a Lewis acid rather than a Lewis base, what will be more reasonable attending the not-bonding pair present in the tin atom. This behavior can be rationalized as a consequence of the inertness of a pair of electron of the tin atom. Thus, for example, tin dichloride accepts chloride ions to give a trigonal pyramidal complex, namely trichloridyl stannate 1-. With respect to the content of these elements in the Earth's crust, we found that carbon ranks 17th in the order of abundance of elements, while silicon is the most abundant element of the periodic table after oxygen. The high presence of silicon contrasts with the low abundance of germanium, around 1.5 grams per ton of crystal rocks, that is 1.5 ppm, ranking about the half of the complete list of elements. Tin is also in the same proportion than the germanium, whilst lead is the most abundant of the heavy elements with 13 ppm. Silicon never occurs free, but it always appears combined with oxygen, usually in a four-coordinated combination. The main natural source of silicon, the pure quartz, which has been employed since the ancient Egyptians, who manufactured it in the form of pearls, vases, or even adornments for their construction. They also learned how to make glass by fusing quartz and alkali, soda or potash, together in crucible of pottery. However, after many scientists' inputs during the 18th century, it was Henri-Étienne Sainte-Claire de Ville who prepared in 1854 silicon by electrolysis, warning by then that this element was not a real metal. Silicon is now usually obtained by heating silicon dioxide with coke at high temperature in an electrical furnace. However, due to that one, the most important application of silicon is in semiconductor industry, it is necessary to obtain it in a high purity. For that reason, it is usually converted to volatile compounds such as trichloroxylene for subsequent purification by exhaustive fractional distillation and final reduction with zinc or magnesium and purification by some refining, which leads to the requiring extremely pure element. The discovery of germanium happens later on time, although interestingly it was predicted by Dmitri Mendeleev in 1871 before it was finally discovered by Clement Alexander Winkel in 1886 when he was working on the analysis of new mineral called argyrodite. Germanium, which is mainly obtained as a byproduct during the extraction of zinc, is frequently also required in high purity, and therefore some melting techniques are also employed. Finally, both tin and lead are known since the ancient times, but there is no evidence of who discovered or isolated any of them for the first time. In the case of tin, it was one of the oldest metals used by ancient civilizations. The importance of tin in antiquity is related with the fact that this element was employed to create bronze, a hard alloy of copper and tin, which enabled people to create artifacts harder and more durable than previous tools employed. The relevance of bronze in history is such that a whole historical period was named after this alloy, the Bronze Age, which is dated from the 3rd millennium before Christ. Nowadays, tin is extracted from the mineral cassiterite, SnO2, by reduction with carbon, and it is a very useful metal due to its resistance to corrosion, as we found it frequently to plate the steel which is used in tin cans. Another important characteristic of tin is that it is the element that have more stable isotopes of any other element, being tin 119 particularly valuable in both NMR and Mossbauer spectroscopies. Finally, in the case of lead, in spite of its toxicity, since it is accumulated in the body and gives symptoms of lead poisoning, it is also one of the oldest metals used by the mankind. In example, Egypt's already described in very old documents by 4000 before Christ. Although some of its uses are banned today, such as its use in plumbing, we found a lot of important applications in our days. Lead in nowadays is extracted from its sulfide ore, galena, which should be first converted to the corresponding oxide and finally reduced with coke. Both tin and lead are usually purified and refined electrolytically, and the recycling of both metals is tremendously important for both environmental and economic concerns. In the following section of this week, you will learn how these elements are still quite relevant in our daily life. First, we will study silicon, for which we dedicate a whole learning sequence due to its extraordinary significance, and then we explore the great importance of germanium, tin and lead. You will realize that the production and use of this element nowadays is still highly valuable for the mankind.